Good evening. Good evening. It's wonderful to see all of you in person after the hiatus imposed by the pandemic. And it is my honor today to welcome the guest speaker, Sanjeev Sanyal, Chairman Intact, Major General L.K. Gupta, Member Secretary Dr. C.T. Misra, Mrs. Anita Singh, and all the distinguished guests in the audience here to the 12th Popul Jaikar Memorial Lecture. The lecture, as you would know, was started to honor the memory of Srimati Popul Jaikar, one of the founding members of INTAC and whose passion for heritage preservation is well known. May I request Chairman INTAC, our guest speaker and Member Secretary, to please come up on stage. I now request Chairman and Member Secretary to kindly welcome the guest speaker with flowers and a compilation of the earlier Popul Jaikar Memorial Lectures. Before we begin the lecture, I'll request Chairman INTAC to release the book, Conserving the Spirit of a Historic Garden. The book is based on an INTAC-sponsored research grant to address various issues directed towards conservation of historic gardens. It is authored by Dr. Praleen Singh, who explains the Florence Charter on Historic Gardens in a very fluid manner. Praleen, if you could come up on stage for a photo op, please. Dr. Praleen Singh is the Professor of Architectural Heritage at the School of Planning and Architecture, New Delhi. Thank you. I would request Chairman INTAC to please address the audience.
Hello, can you hear me, please? Honored guest, Sri Sanjeev Sanyalji, writer and economist. Dear members of INTAC and members of audience, ladies and gentlemen, I welcome you to this lecture. I shall briefly say what is INTAC and what is INTAC about. INTAC was established with the aim that people must be involved in valuing and saving their heritage, as government alone cannot save it. Flowing from this noble aim, INTAC is made up of two distinct wings, a volunteer wing and a professional wing. volunteer to connect with the people and bring their passion for awareness of heritage, to save it, to prevent damage to the heritage. The professional thing is to acquire and provide that professional expertise and knowledge for conservation of our heritage. During the first 10 years of its founding in 1984, INTACT became a national organization spreading all over India with around 144 chapters, centers across the states. It introduced the disciplines of conservation of architectural heritage and its teachings in India, conservation of art objects which earlier needed to be sent overseas for conservation, as there are no such facilities available to the public apart from some ASI, by establishing ring of conservation labs across the corners of country and training people in conservation of art. It also fought to conserve our rivers like Ganga and Yamuna, leading to plans such as Ganga Action Plan, Yamuna Action Plan. Ladies and gentlemen, presently, INTACT has acquired a stature as a center of excellence with about 226 chapters across the country. It possesses world-class expertise in conservation of art objects, architectural heritage, natural heritage, listing and documenting India's diverse heritage. And this knowledge is also shared, sourced both by the ASI and even the Niti Aayog of this country. In short, the aim of INTACT is to become a knowledge center of our heritage, both tangible and intangible, as also of world-class professional knowledge to conserve our heritage, to include conservation of water, farmlands, our native seeds, flora and fauna. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much, as I said, to spare your time and attend this lecture. Thank you very much. All the best.
Thank you, sir. And now it is time to introduce the guest speaker for the 12th Pupul Jaikar Memorial Lecture to the audience. And making the introduction is Member Secretary Dr. Misra. Ma'am.
Namaste and good evening. Chairman INTACT, members of INTACT, and dear friends, thank you so much for being here with us, even though the President of India disrupted our program, which was originally supposed to be in the IIC, but you have taken the trouble to come to our new venue, and I'm sure many people mustn't have been able to reach or didn't get the intimation, but we have the YouTube and the streaming going on, so many people are seeing this program on a streaming mode. Every year, INTACT celebrates the World Heritage Day by commemorating the memory of Srimati Pupul Jaikar, who contributed immensely in setting up and laying the foundation of INTACT, which today has grown into a sturdy big tree with a large number of branches throughout the country. Our speaker today is young Sanjeev Sanyal. He may be a well-known person in his own right, but to me, he is still young Sanjeev, because his father, who is sitting there, is my colleague. It's not your father, sorry. Is my colleague. To introduce him with so many accomplishments to his name makes me feel a sense of pride at the younger generation of India who can take up so many responsibilities and interests and yet enjoy and immerse themselves in what they believe in passionately. Sanjeev is currently a member of the Economic Advisory Council of the Prime Minister and Secretary to the Government of India. Early on, he was the principal economic advisor to the finance minister. He has represented India at many international forums such as OECD and G7 and was the co-chair for the G20's Framework Working Group. He was one of the main architects of the G20's Global Action Plan that was used to coordinate the international response to the COVID-19 pandemic. Prior to joining the government, he spent over 2 decades in the financial sector with Deutsche Bank. Sanjeev is an alumni of Sri Ram College of Commerce, Delhi, and later attended Oxford University as a Rhodes Scholar. He has had many affiliations, including being a visiting scholar at Oxford University, a fellow of the Royal Geographical Society, London, visiting professor at Jawaharlal Nehru University, Delhi, senior fellow of the World Wildlife Fund. He was awarded the Eisenhower Fellowship in 2007 for his work on urban dynamics. In 2010, he was named as a young global leader by the World Economic Forum in Davos. More closer to our heart in INTAC, he is the author of a number of best-selling books, including Land of the Seven Rivers, The Ocean of Churn, India in the Age of Ideas, and The Indian Renaissance. Today, he will give us a talk on the idea of Bharat, a history of a civilizational identity. I am quite sure that everybody present here is eagerly looking forward to his thoughts and ideas on this most interesting subject, the idea of Bharat and our civilizational identity. I welcome Sanjeev and request him to give the talk. Thank you.
Don't worry, it works. Okay. Good evening, everyone. Let me begin by thanking INTAC and specifically Major General Gupta and Dr. Mishra for giving me this opportunity to deliver the 12th Pupul Jaikar Memorial Lecture. And of course, to all of you for making it here on a very, very hot day to listen to a fairly heavy subject. So, thank you. The topic that I've chosen to speak on is about the idea of Bharat, and specifically a history of a civilizational idea. And the point I'm going to make is that the idea of Bharat as a civilizational identity is a very, very old one. Indeed, it is repeated not just in very ancient texts, but also in medieval texts, not just by Indians, but by foreigners who came here or knew about India. And oddly enough, it's only in the colonial period that there was some questioning of the idea that Indians may not have a somewhat unifying civilizational identity. And that perhaps we were just some sort of a random patchwork of peoples who may have been sharing a geographical space, but had nothing else to do with each other. So I'm going to actually start with that, because it's important to know why we are here at all, because if there was no debate about this issue in ancient and medieval times. So one of the things that happened in the late 19th century is that colonial administrators, intellectuals, historians, and so on, suddenly took it upon themselves to begin questioning what had been considered till then obvious received wisdom, which is that Indians had a clear cultural and civilizational unity of some sort. So you have statements like this one by Sir John Strachey. He was the acting Viceroy of India in 1872, and he said, "The first and most essential thing to learn about India, that there is not and never was an India." And then he goes on to make a somewhat longer statement, which I don't have here, about why he thought so. And it's a similar sentiment that comes through from Winston Churchill when he says, "India is a geographical term. It is no more united a nation than the equator." Now, I can understand that a colonial power, having taken over a country, would want to spread this kind of idea. In fact, the British Empire and other Europeans commonly use the idea of terra nullius, which means empty land, whenever they turned up at a location like, say, for example, Australia or New Zealand and so on. Terra nullius literally means empty land. It doesn't matter, of course, that there were already people living there. By creating this legal fiction, effectively it allowed the colonial powers to colonize and simply ignore the historical rights of those who happened to live in that space. Incidentally, the basic concept of terra nullius was in place as recently as the early 90s in Australia. So it's not some theoretical thing that happened back in the 19th century. So it's an important part of the colonial experience. But in India, of course, the problem was that there were obviously people here, and they obviously had been here for a very long time. And so they couldn't simply say that this was empty. And so they began to create this fiction that Indians never thought of themselves as a people, that they didn't really have any sense of their history, and so on and so forth. So what I'm going to do is take you a long way back to when the word Bharata was first used. Now the word Bharata, the term Bharata, is first used in the Rig Veda, which, as many of you will know, is an early Bronze Age text. There's a debate about how old it is, but my own sense is that it is from somewhere in the range of 3500 to 4500 BC. And I have another talk, which is on YouTube, which you can see why I think that is the rough date of this document. But in there, it mentions a tribe, and it's a tribe at this stage, called the Bharata or Trutsu tribe. And this tribe lives along the banks of a river called Saraswati. Now this is important because the Rig Veda goes on to sharp praises on the Saraswati River. Its name appears 72 times. It's lauded as the great flood, the great among the great, the impetuous of rivers, limitless, unbound, swift flowing. It calls it Sindhu Mata, or the mother of rivers. Now, very often you've had attempts to say that this is a mythical river, or this happens to be somewhere in Central Asia and so on. But it's quite clear from the text that this is a real river, because there are scenes of the Bharatas, for example, going to war, crossing this river and so on. And there are later texts too which talk about this river, and in fact about how it dries up. So it's very clear in the Vedic texts that this is a real river. In fact, given its link to the Bharata tribe, it's also very often referred to as Bharati. In fact, when you do Saraswati Puja, very often you will hear it, the puja mantras end with something in the lines of Bhagavati Bharati Devi Namaste. So it is even today in much later texts and much later times, still the link to the Bharatas and the Saraswati is still there. Now the question is, where was the Saraswati? Again, unnecessary controversy about it being somewhere in Central Asia or some such place. The Rig Veda is very, very clear about where the Saraswati is. There is something called the Nadi Stuti Suktam in the Rig Veda, book 10. I've given you the name, verse, etc., so that you can check it for yourself. And it goes as follows: O Ganga, Yamuna, Saraswati, Shutudru, which is the Satlej, Parushni, Ravi, Askini, the Chenab, and so on. And as you can see, this Nadi Stuti Suktam is essentially enumerating all the rivers of northern India going east to west. And there is no doubt about where exactly the Saraswati is. It's between the Yamuna and the Shatrudra. Okay? Then the Rig Veda tells us something else. It tells us that this river flows from the mountains to the ocean. So it says, again, book 7, and the hymn and stanza are given there in the presentation. And there's a stanza which says, pure in a course from the mountains to the ocean, alone of streams Saraswati hath listened. So again, we know that this is a river between the Yamuna and the Satluj, and it flows from the mountains to the ocean. Now the problem is, of course, that there is no such river flowing today. But that shouldn't be surprising, because later texts, particularly the Mahabharata, clearly mention that this river dried up. But is there any evidence of such a river? And it turns out there is. Whether you take satellite photographs or ground proofing and so on, you can even see some of it very clearly even in Google Maps. There is indeed a paleo channel, that of a river system that we now know as the Ghaggar Hakra Nara. And you can see the green lines where it flows. You can see in the upper reaches it comes out of the Shivalik. It comes out of the mountains just north of the Ghaggar stream, comes right just north of Chandigarh. It then flows through Haryana into northern Rajasthan, out into what is now Pakistan, back, and flows into ultimately the Run of Kutch. And the reason the Run of Kutch looks the way it does, by the way, is that it was originally the estuary of both the Saraswati and of the Sindhu. The Indus, incidentally, used to flow somewhat east of where it does today. And the strange landscape of the Run of Kutch, the salt flats, are essentially the result of the river itself drying up and sea levels declining after the Bronze Age. So it left behind this estuary and the salt flats. So this is what it looked like. Obviously, over tens of thousands of years, this river had a tendency to waver quite a bit, because remember, this is a very flat landscape. And so you can see, particularly in the lower reaches, it sort of spread out, and there were different points in time it then tended to have different channels. But certainly there is more than adequate evidence of a river exactly described as in the Rig Veda. Just so that you know, it is a river that was a very big glacial fed river before the Ice Age. During the Ice Age, it dried up. Then it revived around 9,000 years ago, that's 7,000 BC, after the Ice Age, when the weather changed to becoming much wetter than it is today, and was a very large but rain-fed river. Now, many people in India tend to have this impression that big river, glacial, small river, rain-fed. That's a totally wrong way to think about it. Most of the great rivers in the world, like the Amazon, Nile, etc., are all river-fed. Even all the big rivers in southern India are river-fed, so it's quite possible to have a very large river-fed, rain-fed river. And of course, it's possible it also received some glacial melt. But anyway, there is a river like the Saraswati exactly where you expect it. And interestingly, there is a very large number, in fact the largest concentration of Harappan sites along this dry riverbed. So obviously this was a very important part of the Harappan landscape. You can see it very, very clearly. In fact, some of the oldest sites of the Harappan civilization, and in fact many pre-Harappan sites as well, along this river channel. In fact, I recently went to Kalibangan, which is literally on its banks of this of the Ghaggar river channel. But then, this about 2000 BC, this river dried up, and this was one of the very important reasons why the Harappan civilization, at least the mature period, went into decline. There was some dispersal of population, but even the population that continued to live here basically became rural, because there was a massive drought and it was no longer possible to support large cities. But let's go back to the Rig Veda, which was composed well before all of this well before the Harappan mature period cities, and go back to the early Bronze Age. Now, one of the other terms that along with the Saraswati comes up is that of the Sapta Sindhu, or the land of the seven rivers, which is mentioned very prominently in the Rig Veda. Why is this important? Because this is the homeland of the Bharata tribe. So the question is, where is the Sapta Sindhu and what are those seven rivers? Now, very often, the common perception is that the Sapta Sindhu includes the Indus, the five rivers of Punjab, plus the Saraswati. So that makes the seven rivers. But the problem is that the Rig Veda does not mention which are the seven rivers except one. It is quite clear that the Saraswati is one of those rivers, but the others it does not mention, even though, as you saw in the Nadi Stuti Suktam, they clearly knew about those rivers and had given them names. What it seems, at least to my reading, comes from several stanzas, which I'll read this one, which is also from the book 7 of Rig Veda, which says, "Coming together, glorious, loudly roaring Saraswati, mother of floods, the seventh, with copious milk, with fair streams strongly flowing, fully swelled by the volume of their waters." It seems fairly clear to me what you're describing here is that the other six rivers were essentially flowing into the Saraswati. In other words, what we're dealing with is a river system. The Saraswati is the main river, and there are six rivers flowing into it. Basically, you're dealing with a much smaller geographical area, the Saraswati, and its tributaries. In modern terms, this would be essentially Haryana, a bit of northern Rajasthan, and maybe a little bit of eastern Punjab, but a much, much smaller area. So we are dealing with a tribe from a relatively small area. And this is corroborated, by the way, by the Mahabharata. So in the Mahabharata, Balram goes on a pilgrimage. As many of you will know, he didn't participate in the Kurukshetra war. He went on a pilgrimage along the Saraswati, and he walks along the dried riverbed of the Saraswati till a place called Vinashana, where all the river had gone into it was flowing the northern end, and it was coming together and disappearing into the desert. And then he walks further up to a place where all these tributaries are coming together. And the Mahabharata tells us in book 11, the Shalya Parva, that these are the seven streams of the Saraswati: the Suparva, the Kancha, Nakshi, Vishala, Manorama, Oghavati, Surenu, and the Vimalodaka. Now notice, this is not the seven rivers of Punjab and Sindhu. There's a whole bunch of other rivers. Of course, complicating the interpretation is the fact that we don't know where any of those rivers are, except again one, which is, it says here that the Saraswati, full of sacred waters, flows past Kurukshetra under the name of Oghavati. So at least we know that the Oghavati of these seven rivers used to flow past Kurukshetra, again Haryana. So all of it generally now fits into a picture of Haryana. So now the question is, if we are dealing with such a small tribe from the Rig Veda, from basically from Haryana, why are they so important that they should end up giving the whole of this country this name? And to understand that, again you have to go back to the Rig Veda and try and understand the one political event that is clearly mentioned in the Rig Veda, which is the Battle of the Ten Kings. So it turns out that at some point in time, in the far past, the Bharata Trutsu tribe had a chieftain called Sudasa, who was a son or grandson of another chieftain called Divodas. And at some point in time, a coalition of 10 tribes from the west or northwest decided to attack the Bharatas. So Sudas and his guru, Rishi Vashishth, basically rallied the troops, and they crossed the Saraswati, and they moved out to meet this coalition of 10 tribes which were coming in from the west. and there was a huge battle on the banks of the Ravi, in which the Bharatas completely destroyed the coalition. And there are these descriptions of how many of the enemy were drowned in the river as a result, as they fled away from the Bharatas. In fact, it tells us that 6,066 of the enemy warriors were killed, which I suppose in the context of that time was a pretty large number. Now, having defeated the Western alliance, the Bharatas now turned eastward and they seem to have defeated another chieftain called Bheda on the banks of the Yamuna. So therefore, they came in possession of the first known empire in Indian history, and of course this empire was ruled by the Bharata tribes. But that is not what was really remarkable about this. What is remarkable is what they did next. See, it is quite common for imperialist tribes or religions, etc., at any point in history, to impose their own ideas on whoever they have conquered. But however, the Bharatas did something quite different. What they did is they invited the rishis of even the defeated tribes to come to some sort of a conference. It seems they even invited those they had not defeated, perhaps, of neighboring tribes and so on, of who they knew. And they compiled all the ideas, rituals, hymns and so on into one big document which we now know as the Veda Samhitas. It was at a later day divided up into the Rig, Sam and so on. But the compilation of all this information was done under the auspices of the Bharata tribe. Now this is quite an extraordinary idea if you think about it, because this is an idea of assimilation rather than of imposition. And this is the reason that many thousands of years later, I, a Bengali who come from far in the east, know myself as a Bharata. Because a long time ago, my ancestors signed up to this idea that essentially we could all contribute our ideas into this template of Indic civilization which had come together, put together in the Vedas. It's not something I'm just making up, because it's explicitly expressed in the Vedas. And I'm going to read out to you the very last chant or hymn in the Rig Veda in book 10. It's the very last one in the Rig Veda itself, which says, "Assemble, speak together, let your minds be of all of one accord. As ancient gods unanimously sit around at their appointed chair, this place is common, common the assembly, common the mind, so be their thought united. A common purpose do I lay before you and worship with your general oblation. One and the same be your resolve, and be your minds of one accord. United be the thoughts of all, united be the thoughts of all, that all may be happily agree." There are different translations of this, but broadly you can see what is going on here. Essentially, all the ancient gods have a space around the sacrificial fire. That is the important idea. And so, whatever my ancestors used to worship far in the past, maybe since I am a Shakta myself and a worshipper of the Devis, maybe the Devis were incorporated and given a space around the sacrificial fire. And that is how my ancestors ended up calling themselves Bharatas. Now, this idea of assimilation seems to have been quite a powerful idea, because it seems to spread over the centuries across the subcontinent and even beyond. And of course, we have the stories of individual rishis going and spreading these ideas. For example, Agastya Muni crossing the Vindhyas and going down south. You have the story of Bhrigus, the Bhrigu family, moving down towards Gujarat, and then his descendants, particularly his descendant Parashuram, going all the way along the Konkan coast and so on. And as a result of which, by the Puranic period, which by the way is a couple of thousand years later at least, because the language of the Puranas is very, very different from that of the Rig Veda. It's almost a different language. But you can see by the time of the Puranic period, the meaning of the land of seven rivers has clearly changed. And the idea of the Sapta Sindhu now has spread in post-Vedic periods to cover the entire subcontinent. So there is a very well-known chant, which is very often used during ritual bathing. It's from the Brahma Vairavata Purana. It's the Brahma Kanda. It goes somewhat like this. Gangecha Yamune Chaiva Godavari Saraswati Narmade Sindhu Kaveri Jalismin Sandhinim Kuru. Many of you may already know this one, but I will still translate it. O Ganga Yamuna Godavari Saraswati Narmada Indus Kaveri Rivers, may all your waters come together to cleanse me. So you can see the idea of the Sapta Sindhu has now covered the entire subcontinent. And this shows up in many, many other texts. But before I go there, let me pick up something that might have occurred to you already, which is that most of you may not even have heard of this Raja Sudas that I have just talked about. Most of you will probably be under the impression that the name Bharata comes from a king, Bharat, and that this Bharat is the son of Dushyant and Shakuntala. Now this idea, however, is a much later idea which comes ironically from Kalidas. It is not there in any of our ancient texts, but our ancient texts do mention a Raja Bharat. He is, interestingly, and by the way, this is also corroborated by Jain texts as well, but the Puranas are clear that he was the son of Rishabha and the grandson of Nabhi, and that this Raja Bharat conquered the subcontinent, and that he conducted the Rajasuya and Ashwamedha and was declared the Chakravartin, or the universal monarch. Now this is very interesting, because remember, Sudas too had conducted the Ashwamedha Yajna after his conquests and done the Rajasuya and declared himself the Chakravartin. In fact, Sudas is the first one who did it, and Raja Bharat seems to have also done the same thing. But now there is a problem. What is the link between Raja Sudas and Raja Bharat? Are they the same people? Is it the case that somehow Raja Bharat is some distant memory embellished over the centuries of Raja Sudas? The answer is I do not know. It's quite possible that they were different kings, who both conquered large tracts and conducted the Ashwamedha Yajna and consequently became Chakravartins. I don't know. But I thought I'll leave you with another interesting fact. Incidentally, Raja Bharat's grandfather, Nabhi, was also a great king, and he had also done the Ashwamedha Yajna and conquered all of Bharatvarsha. And the Puranas say that before Bharatvarsha was called Bharatvarsha, it was actually called Nabhi Varsha. Now, I am quite certain nobody in this room had any idea that India had another name called Nabhi Varsha. I didn't know this till just a few weeks ago, till my friend, philosopher and guide, Vivek Debroy, told me about this. So something I found out while researching this this talk. Nonetheless, it is quite clear, whether it was Sudasa of the Bharata tribe or King Bharat of a later time, there was this idea, an idea of unifying the subcontinent in some way by a Chakravartin. And that is interesting, because the symbol of the Chakravartin is the wheel. And the wheel is to this day on our national flag. We tend to talk, of course, about the Mauryan or Ashokan Chakra. And we tend to think of this as something that came, sort of popped up during Ashokan times, maybe under the influence of Buddhism. But the idea of a universal monarch is much, much older, and it is related to the idea of the Chakravartin, or the universal monarch. Of course, the Buddhists then took the same idea to say Buddha was the universal monarch in the spiritual plane, and so they would use the chakra as symbolizing Buddha. The Mauryan chakra may have been inspired by that, or it may simply be that the Mauryans who were trying to also express that the fact that they were Chakravartins, having conquered most of the subcontinent. So I suppose the national emblem with four growling lions and the symbol of the Chakravartin are quite correctly used today as a symbol of the Indian state. Now, one is to say that there was this idea of Bharat, and it's very ancient. But what were the dimensions of this? What are these descriptions of this Bharata? What do the ancient texts say about this? So I, of course, talked earlier about how the idea of Saptasindhu had spread. But the dimensions of the Bharatvarsha is very clearly described in all the Puranas. The Vishnu Puran is the usual one that is quoted very often. So I have deliberately gone and quoted another Puran, the Brahma Puran, but there is some version of this in almost all the Puranas. So what do they say? Well, you can clearly see an idea of the subcontinent's geographical and civilizational unity right up front, which says the Varsha that is north of the ocean and south of the Himalayas is known by the name Bharata, and the people there are known as Bharati. It also says that the Kiratas, which are the Tibeto-Burman people, live to the east, and the Yavanas, that is the Greeks, live to the west. Now this is also interesting because it dates this text. Because when would, of course, the Kiratas or Tibeto-Burmans still live to our east? But when were the Greeks living to our west? Well, they did between the invasion of Alexander till when the Central Asians like the Kushans evicted the Indo-Greeks. So that was the period. It would have been 2nd, 1st centuries BC. So we can roughly date again when this sort of conception of India was being put together in the Brahma Purana. The Puranas then go on to say what's inside India. So that was the boundaries of India by the mountains and the ocean. What is there inside India? Well, it says, again, 7 seems to be a rather popular number. It says there are 7 mountain ranges and it names them. It says Mahendra, which is Eastern Ghats, the Malaya Mountains, which is the Southern Western Ghats and the Nilgiris. It says Sahya, the Northern Western Ghats, which is the bit in Maharashtra, etc., which is still called the Sahyadri, by the way. Then there's the Riksha, which is the Satpuras, which is Central India. The Vindhya, which in those days meant the Eastern Vindhyas, which is from Chunar, which is Vindhyachal, out west eastward, and the Pariyatra, which is the western Vindhyas, which is from Vindhyachal westwards. Notice I left out one mountain range called the Suktimat. That's because I haven't quite figured out the exact location of this. I'm guessing it is the Aravallis. And those of you from the northeast, in case you're feeling left out, well, the Brahma Puran also says there are those who reside in the east, such as the inhabitants of Kamarupa. Other Puranas may mention Prag, Jyotishpur, etc., but this is what's there in the Brahma Puran. There are further descriptions of rivers that come out of all of these ranges. So again, you can cross-reference and sort of know which of these is which. Which is one of the reasons I haven't been able to figure out Suktimat, because I couldn't figure out the names of those rivers. There is a river Kamala which comes out of the Suktimat mountains, but that in modern times seems to be a river which comes out of the Himalayas into the Gangetic plains, and this lot is not the Himalayan mountains named here. So therefore I wasn't able to identify it, and I haven't found good identification in any other text either. So a project for some of you in the audience. Now, one of the other interesting things is that although there is this clear expansion of the idea of India to cover the subcontinent, there is still a memory that there is something special about Haryana. And the code of Manu, the Manusmriti, mentions that there is a land created by the gods which lies between the divine rivers Saraswati and the Drishadvati, which is the Ghaggar. There's another dry riverbed of the Chautang, and modern Haryana is broadly between them. And he calls them Brahmavarta, the region of Brahman. And all the people in the earth should learn their respective practices from the priests born in this land. And Kurukshetra and the land of the Matsyas, the Panchalas and the Surasenakas constitute the land of the seers. So again, you can see there's something very special about this area. Now, what about other parts of the world? What did they think about India in this period? Now, the oldest known sort of reference to India comes in Sumerian texts where they mention the Meluhans, but they don't say very much more about where the Meluhans came from beyond saying that they brought with them ivories and peacocks, etc., which suggests that they're Indians. But they don't describe India as such. So the earliest one where they mention India itself comes from the Avestan text, which is the oldest Zoroastrian texts, which was the ancient religion of Iran. And there, it is interesting, incidentally, that these Avestan texts are composed in a language which is very, very close to Rig Vedic Sanskrit. So much so that we know, we understand the Avesta better today than we ever did before because of Vedic scholars reading them. There's only one small change in the pronunciation, however. The Vedic sa becomes the Avestan her. Incidentally, something that happened in modern Assamese as well. Now, therefore, you have in the text the mention of Hapta Hindu, which is obviously Sapta Sindhu, and Harahwati, which is the Saraswati. But it's also interesting the context in which this is told to us. You see, the Avestans' religion or the seems to have had some sort of a intellectual conflict with the Indians, because in the Avestan texts, the demons are known as the Devas, and the great god is Ahura, the Asura Mazda, which obviously flips the Indian vision of the same good and bad dichotomy. Now, one important caveat here, the Rig Vedic texts on the other hand don't have this dichotomy. In the Rig Vedic texts, the Asuras and the Devas are thus just two different sets of gods. In fact, gods like Varuna are actually described, and Rudra is also described as an Asura. But in later texts, there is clearly a dichotomy between the Asuras and the Devas. The Devas become good and the Asuras are known as evil. There is an exact flip of this in the Avestan texts. And the context, therefore, in which this is mentioned is quite interesting. It's there in a section called the Vendidad, which is actually short for V Devodata, which literally means against the Devas. So this is the section where this is mentioned. And there it mentions that Angara Mainyu, the leader of the Devas, has taken away these lands, Hapta Hindu and Harahwati. So he's taking that, you know, Saraswati and Sapta Hindu, Sindhu have clearly, the Devas have taken it away. And then it goes on to say, the Sapta Sindhu has become too hot, whereas the people of the beautiful Saraswati are now violate the funerary rites by burying their dead. Because remember, the Zoroastrians do not either bury or cremate. Whereas we know the Vedic people used to both cremate and bury their dead. So clearly, this was some religious dispute at that point in time. And so it correlates with what the Western said. There are other foreign descriptions of India as well. You have Chinese, Greek, Arab and other foreigners who, both in ancient and in medieval times, clearly described India as a geographical and civilizational unit. The ancient Greco-Roman words are Indioi, India. Megasthenes talks about Indica. The ancient Chinese have several variations on the Sindhu. So you have Yandu or Chindu or Tianzu, etc. Ancient Greeks have Handwi, which comes from the hieroglyphics. This is the sounds. Medieval Arabs talk about Al-Hind. You have Al-Biruni's book on India, which describes, again, clearly the civilizational unity of the country, despite the political divisions. And this is important to remember. Very often those who deny the civilizational unity of India say, oh, you know, there were all these kingdoms fighting against each other. And my answer to this is, so what? The Greeks also had many city-states. They were fighting with each other all the time. But they also had a sense of civilizational nationhood. I mean, it is quite one thing to fight each other, but it's quite different when the Persians turned up or when the Olympic Games was held. And you see that with others as well. The Chinese, for example, contrary to popular belief, spend most of their history actually in some warring states condition. So only once in a while gigantic empires arose. So the fact that there was political disunity and internal rebellion and wars, etc., does not take away from the fact that you may have had a strong sense of civilizational unity. It is also, of course, very worrying in the case of Al-Biruni's book that he then spends a fair amount of time providing clear estimates of distances as measured to various corners of India from Kannauj and from a sacred river in Prayag. Now, this is rather worrying because remember, he was a spy who was sent by Mahmud of Ghazni to spy in India. So, he was clearly taking measurements and which were used in later times to somewhat unhappy consequences. Now, what happens in medieval times? I talked about the ancient times idea of India. What happens in medieval times? Now, again, you can clearly see the distribution of the Shakti Pithas. Now, the Shakti worship has, from very ancient times, had there's some form of Shakti worship is there across India, but there is a concentration to eastern India. But certainly by medieval times, it spreads across India. And it's not a random distribution. You can see the easternmost one, to this day, by the way, the easternmost Shakti Pitha is in Tripura, the Tripura Sundari temple. When westernmost is in Balochistan, Hinglaj Mata. Northernmost, Sharada Peet, which is now in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. And the southernmost is Kanyakumari. And then there is all this other distribution as you can see. And again, the original Rigvedic idea of unity comes through again. What do these Shakti Peets mean? They are the pieces of the body of Sati herself. And why did this happen? So again, let's go back. Because unlike the other gods, Shiva was denied his place around the sacrificial fire. Therefore, by the Vedic compact, it was already an invalid yajna because he did not. All the ancient gods, including Shiva, were supposed to have a place around the fire, and Shiva had been denied this. And so Sati sacrifices herself and violates the yajna. And then she's cut up into pieces and thrown across this landscape, which is a sacred landscape, and in her own body unites it. So you can clearly see that that Vedic idea is being echoed here. And again you see that being the same idea coming through in Shankaracharya's yatras again around India. It happens in the 8th century. And again he, as you can see, travels around all over. This is not a random landscape that he is traversing. And it's also not random where he places his original mutts. He established them in Puri, Sringeri, Dwarka, and Badrinath, the four corners of a sacred geography. And of course, this geography is united in many, many ways through various pilgrimages. Again, same idea remembered in modern times. Vivekananda in 1890 to 1892, he goes to many of these same sites, incidentally. And you can see this is not a random landscape that he is traversing. He's clearly going around a certain sacred geography that is sort of laid out and clear sense of civilizational unity. Now, the point that I have made here is the idea of Bharat is certainly very, very ancient, but it is also evolving. It started out in basically where we are right now in Haryana, Delhi area. But it spread over these thousands of years. And along the way, it collected all kinds of new ideas. This included new indigenous ideas. It also included many foreign ideas that came through trade, migration, invasion, exchange of ideas. Many of the things that we think are quintessentially Indian from ancient times are actually foreign things. Like, for example, Pan Supari. The supari is a Southeast Asian plant. And the custom of chewing pan is actually a Southeast Asian import that in some very ancient times was brought here and has become so much a part of everything Indian that we do not realize this. And of course, all this is all true right to this time, whether it's in food, where, you know, the tomato and potato are brought here from South America by the Portuguese, or the various kinds of architecture, which we have clearly influenced by Central Asia and the Persians, or the game of cricket, or and the language in which I am speaking to you, are clearly already part of Indic civilization. Now, the fact that it is, however, evolving does not mean that it isn't something real. It would be, after all, the English language is also evolving all the time. That doesn't mean the English language does not exist. It does. So the fact that something evolves does not mean that it is not real. And also, at the same time, while acknowledging the importance of foreign contributions, it is also important, however, not to extend this to celebrating our own subjugation. Unfortunately, people tend to confuse the two. It is perfectly okay to enjoy a game of cricket, enjoy the beauty of the English language, or even enjoy an English breakfast, and not be particularly enthusiastic about the colonial occupation of India. Now, even the geographical expanse of the civilization is not static. Today, it may be manifest in the borders of the Republic of India. But of course, there were periods of time when it included parts of Central Asia all the way down to Southeast Asia. This is not a theoretical thing. Indonesia, when it became an independent country in 1949, named itself Indonesia, which is clearly derived from India. Its national emblem is Vishnu's Garuda. Its currency is the rupiah. So here is another country that clearly remembers this civilizational link and celebrates it. So again, there is no reason for us to be apologetic about the idea of Bharat, or how ancient it is, or the fact that it is an idea that had at various points in time influenced various parts of the world. Importantly, the founders of the Republic of India were conscious of this. And they were very clear that the modern republic was a modern manifestation of an ancient civilizational nation. So, in a speech at the time, at the point when we gained independence, at midnight, on the 15th of August 1947, Jawaharlal Nehru, in his speech, says, of course, "When the soul of a nation, long suppressed, finds utterance." And the same idea is there, by the way, in the very first line of the Constitution of the Indian Republic. It says, "India, that is Bharat, shall be a union of states." Now, if Bharat was merely about being a union of states, then the English version would have been, "India shall be a union of states," and then in the Hindi version would just have used Bharat. Right? That is not what they did. They specifically talk about India, that is Bharat, remembering the very long history of this nation to that point. And that's saying then that now, this nation already exists. Now going forward, this modern manifestation in the form of this republic shall be, going forward, a union of states. So this is what those who wrote the Constitution wanted to convey. It is there, incidentally, in the original version of the Constitution. If you go and look at it, there are these absolutely wonderful sketches which actually sort of sketches out in literal terms this long history on the very pages of the Constitution. So let me end by saying that Jawaharlal Nehru, on the 15th of August, did not stand up and say the following thing: "When the soul of a union of states long suppressed found utterance." Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I will now be quite happy to answer questions. I think we have a little bit of time for that. But please do wait for one of the mics to come to you, because this is being live transmitted and they can't hear you if you don't have the mic with you. So may I request person with the mic, if anybody wants to speak, they can raise their hand and the mic will be brought to you. Please state your name and then your question.
Good evening, sir. My name is Yukti Kavya Tripathi. Sir, I'm from Miranda House and I'm currently a student of history honors myself. So all of it resonates with me and what I'm studying. So you quoted about Al-Biruni. And so I've read that Al-Biruni has said that India is a nation which has both cultural and geographical connotations attached to it. But at the same time, what I also read is from scholars like Aye Khan, which is Iktidar Alam Khan, when he says that in the light of these examples, one may suggest that we cannot always accept what Al-Biruni is writing. So there's always, what I noticed from my particular study is there's always a pick and choose from scholars which happens with different sources which are there. You yourself mentioned that he was a spy and all of that, but that has been drastically denied from what I learn. So other scholars also say that the idea of India is not a discovery, but it is an innovation which only happened after the colonialists incarcerated us. And all of this is what I'm studying. So how do you reconcile your version of the idea of Bharat and to what is being pedagogically taught to me? And how should we really establish the fact that evolution doesn't put a question mark on its existence? So there is a quote in Ramcharitmanas which says that Sachiv Ved Guru Teen Jo Pri Bole Bhayas Raj Dharma Tan Teen Ko Hoye Bhegyay Nash. So it means that Sachiv, which is the secretary, and Ved means the doctor, and Guru means the teacher, of course. If they are telling you the wrong thing, everything will be destroyed. Yeah. So this is what is being, this is what I am facing at the outset, and I'm very concerned about the situation which our country will face unless the particular idea that you are advancing is does not come out.
So you have raised an absolutely important question, and which is the reason why I'm here to talk about this, because you have this peculiar situation which you yourself described, that, you know, a recent secondary source scholar quotes a primary source and says that primary source is not to be believed for anything that I don't accept. Now this is rather odd, because the same scholar would have happily quoted the bits of Al-Biruni that suit him. So the point is, you've got to read the whole text. Or even if you do deny it, you cannot just deny it. You have to provide other evidence of somebody who says the opposite. But there isn't one. Is there another non-Al-Biruni from the same period who says the Indians are not no more united than the equator? No. This only pops up, incidentally, even amongst the British in the second half of the 19th century. Even before that, they are also quite happy to accept what was then conventionally accepted by everybody, that there was a certain civilizational and national unity in India. But in the second half of the 19th century, you begin to see this new narrative being built. And of course, this new narrative is very convenient for various ideologies in the 20th century, some of which have continued into continue to be in your textbooks, clearly. This is the reason it is very important to go back and show the original texts. I have therefore gone out of my way to make sure that in every case where I've quoted something, I've told you exactly which verse, which line, etc. You don't have to take my word for it. Go back and check it yourself. Thank you. Yes. The gentleman here and then the gentleman behind you.
Congratulations. I've been hearing you on YouTube and all. The first time I'm seeing you in person. Great work. This evidence that India is one civilization came to me as a shock about 10 years ago when I was organizing a seminar on Indian languages. And what came across in during that three-day seminar, it was a small seminar where we were interacting very closely, and something got revealed, which was that all Indian languages and all Indian dialects, including Tamil, because Tamil, it's an independent language in the sense it has doesn't claim to have any connection with Sanskrit. The formation of all sentences is in a particular manner. That is, everything happens. If you give me some work or I give you some work and you do that work, you will come back and tell me, ye kaam ho gaya. Ho gaya. In English, you will say the work is done. Hmm. So in all Indian languages, everything happens. मेरा हाथ जल जाता है बंगाली में भी ऐसे ही होगा मराठी में भी ऐसे ही होगा तमिल में भी ऐसे ही होगा मेरा हाथ जल गया आई बर्न्ड माय हैंड राइट the senses of doership. Now this haath jal gaya, shaadi ho gayi, bachcha ho gaya, kaam ho gaya. This runs across all Indian land, pan Indian hai, upar se niche, left to right. This is, and all, whether it's French or German or English, the sense is that there is a doership, which is very important. And you can connect it to what in Gita, when they say that, bhai kaam pe dhyan do, matlab, result is not in your hands. Aapka uspe adhikar nahi hai. At least that's the way I read that shloka. That you don't have the right over the, it's a statement of truth. It is not an upadesh. So this was a great revelation for me, that those who say that India is not one civilization, how did it happen that all Indian languages...
So it is not just about language, incidentally. All our scripts are actually essentially the same. You'll be surprised, despite what they may look ostensibly, they all have the same origin.
Mm-hmm.
They have the same logic.
Mm.
And interestingly, if you read Chola coins, I, as a Bengali, can read a Chola coin. A modern Tamil will have difficulty reading it.
Hmm.
Because many of the letters are actually similar to today's Bengali.
Right. Right.
So, Rajendra Chola's coin has Chol written in it with in the Bengali alphabet. I don't know why that is the case. Because at that point in time, this was not the script used in Bengal.
But my question and my concern is...
Yes.
See, some of us sitting here, my understanding would be, my guess would be that 80-85%, 90% sort of agree with the kind of work you are doing. But the larger, especially the intellectual crowd sitting, I'm not from Delhi. I just happen to be here right now. But the Delhi is full of, and all metropolitan cities, whether it's Calcutta or Bombay or wherever, the universities are full of people who are busy taking forward the same narrative which has been going on for the last 200 years. You know.
Yes, and so there is a longer conversation, because of interest of time.
Right.
There is obviously a longer conversation about the curriculums that have been introduced, how they have been deliberately subverted, first by the colonial period, but interestingly, after a brief period of correction in the 1950s, when scholars like R.C. Mazumdar, etc., were trying to do that. But after that, from the 60s onwards, when R.C. Mazumdar was essentially pushed out, and you had these Marxist Nehruvian scholars essentially systematically undoing much of that, you see this new narrative come. And of course, at the end of over 60, 70 years of this, you have this really bizarre narrative which just does not any longer fit in with anything, any of the primary evidence. And you have scholars, which the lady earlier just mentioned, who are simply deny the primary evidence and say, this is not of importance, this is what I'm saying is true. Now, this is bizarre. I mean, this is like, I mean, everybody is allowed their own opinions, but you're not allowed your own facts. Yeah, so there have to be a last question to the gentleman there. I think I'll have to bring this to a close. Another lady at the back end? Okay. Okay, so, I'll take three questions together. Please keep them
very short.
They have to be short. And there should be questions.
Yeah, my question is that, is there a point of reconciliation from Sangam literature, which is in the Iron Age, which says or defines Bharat that we get from Rig Veda?
Okay. So, the Rig Vedic, so Sangam literature, so let me answer this, because the Sangam literature, so those who do not know, is the oldest extant Tamil literature. And inconveniently for those Dravidianists, right in the very beginning, their very oldest literature clearly shows knowledge of the rest of India, of Sanskritic culture and lots of Hindu gods. This is very, very true, because, you know, for example, you take the description of Madurai of the Pandyas, and there is clearly a description of temple about how flowers and chandan, etc., are being sold by the hawkers outside of the temple, and so on and so forth. So the descriptions of Indic civilization as such is very clearly mentioned in the Sangam literature. There is no earlier literature. So, yes, if your point is there a sense of Indianness already in the oldest Tamil literature? Yes, there is. Yeah, sorry.
I'm Guninda Gill, ex-banker, now advocate. In your talk, Sanjeev, you had stressed that the state of Haryana occupied a very special sacred place in the concept of the nation of Bharat. And then you said there wasn't really any Punjab in it, except a little bit of east of Punjab. But isn't Haryana a relatively new political concept? It was earlier Punjab.
No, so this is actually not true. So, of course, the concept of Bharat in the original Rig Veda, and by the way, this is a very long time ago, we are talking 6,000 years ago. There was a conception of Sapta Sindhu, which, as I've told you, was that there was something special about this area. This area was historically called Haryana, even in medieval times. This is a misconception that Haryana name is a modern name. It is not. It has nothing to do with Haryali, incidentally. It means the land of Hari. And it is there in 12th and 11th and 12th century documents, very clearly mentioned. I happened to work till very recently in North Block. And North Block is built on a hill, which is now called Raisina Hill, but it was called something else earlier. And there was, when the construction of North Block was happening, they found a stone inscription there. And it mentions the name of somebody who is building a well in the name of his father in the Pargana of Indraprastha, in the Pargana of Indraprastha, in the Suba of Haryana. So there is a clear name of Haryana in many, many places. In fact, even the British, till at least 1857, used to call this general area Haryana. There was, in fact, they used to hunt the Haryana lions, because there were lots of Haryana lions in what is now Gurgaon. So they used to go hunt the Haryana lions. So it is only after 1857 that this entire area ended up getting merged with Punjab state. This was a very brief period in 60-70 years when this was, 100 years when this was the case. So a 100-year period, Haryana, including Delhi, were a part of Punjab. And the capital of that, incidentally, was Lahore. And Delhi basically became a backwater. And then, of course, Delhi became the capital later. And then after independence, Punjab was divided into three: Himachal, what is still called Punjab, and Haryana. But the name Haryana is not at all a new name. Yes, this will literally have to be the last thing, because I think some of the organizers, Manisha, is clearly getting jittery.
Sanjeev.
Yes.
The way you last line, you say India, that is Bharat, shall be a union of states.
Yes.
The first line of Constitution of India.
Yes.
Can we extrapolate in futuristic way of Akhand Bharat?
Well, it depends what you mean by Akhand Bharat. I mean, Akhand Bharat, the problem with that term is, it will depend very heavily on which period you think be it to be Akhand. If you go to the Vedic Akhand Bharat, you will get lands acquired in Punjab by Sudas and Western UP. There was a medieval period where our conception of what India was would have gone from Afghanistan to Indonesia. There is a later idea of just the subcontinent that would be British India. There is the sacred land of India as what both Vivekananda and before that the Shaktipeets and Shankaracharya done. So this is where it becomes more complicated, because the civilizational idea of Bharat is quite clear. It's evolving and so on. When you apply it to a political entity, it becomes much more complicated. As it stands today, the Bharat is the Republic of India. That is its most modern manifestation. Now, it's quite possible that in a future date, that the Republic of India or some future manifestation of Bharat has a different geographical dimension. But the civilizational dimension, you can see, is a much bigger thing, which, by the way, as I said, also includes Indonesia and Southeast Asia And they themselves, by the way, acknowledge it in its very name of Indonesia.
Yes. So
we have a last
finally,
question.
Yes.
Okay.
I'm actually looking at it from a very different perspective. This is from the perspective of a geographer. So if we look at India, we have all our pilgrimage sites in India. But if you look at Mount Kailash, Mount Kailash is a part of Tibet. And that's the point of origin of our very, very ancient rivers, which were antecedent, which was the Satluj, the Sindhu River, and the Brahmaputra. Yet, as a part of our ancient memory, so whether we take Hindus, whether we take Buddhists, whether we take the Jains, it is considered to be
certainly,
know, a pilgrimage
you're
site.
Absolutely
and that's the
right.
only one which is actually outside India.
So well, no, there are lots of places that are sacred
yeah,
which are outside of today's
yeah.
Boundaries. I
yes.
talked about Hingla Jamata
yes,
is in
yes.
Balochistan.
Yes.
So, of course, we cannot be strict about today's political boundary. You know, for thousands of years,
yeah,
Indians
rivers,
were going to Kailash
absolutely.
And Mansarovar. So, it's civilizationally inside India.
Yeah,
so is Tibet, by the way.
Absolutely. But the interesting thing about these rivers is they rise at levels which are lower than the Himalayas. Yet, these are rivers which have cut across the Himalayas
yes.
and entered India. So, that's a part of our ancient memory that we still, you know,
no, no, of course it
that.
Is. So,
it's,
the
it's really
problem is the modern border which puts Kailash on the, in China is
absolutely.
A completely modern thing. In fact,
yes.
it is so modern that it's, it post-dates even our independence because it was in Tibet, not in China. And Tibet would in many ways be considered a part of our civilizational footprint. So, you're absolutely right that, you know, there is a memory, not just a memory, it's more than a memory. We still go there on pilgrimages. Kailash is a very, very important part of our watershed as well, of our system. So, it is of course important. But, so that's the point I was making earlier. The idea of civilization is old, it's evolved. It is in even in geographical space that it occupied at different points in time, much bigger than the Republic of India as it is today. It's quite few possible in some future date. It may go back to having a larger footprint, even politically. But as it stands today, this is what it is. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. It was a pleasure.
Thank you, Sanjeev. May I request Chairman to present a token of appreciation to the guest speaker. On behalf of the Indian National Trust for Art and Cultural Heritage, I'd like to thank Sanjeev for the enriching talk, which revisits that the discourse on our civilizational identity is important to course correct the colonial narrative, but to also understand what our cultural DNA is that helped India assimilate, evolve into an inclusive, culturally sensitive and plural society, which today is the only and the oldest living civilization in the world. It is an identity that all Indians can own up and be proud of. Our heartfelt thanks also to Anita ji, who stepped in when there was a big crisis and our earlier venue had to be cancelled because of the presidential visit, and it was because of her that this venue was made available to us. My deepest thanks to Kushagra from the Architectural Heritage Division for all his tech support, Devinder, who sincerely took ownership of a lot of back-end work, Praveen ji for all the running around, and the entire team from the admin who pitched in to ensure a smooth event. Last but not the least, thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for being a part of this event. Good night.